Hey there, this is Jack from Heroes and Legends, and welcome to part two of our six-part Kaladesh full set review. Today we're going to look at all of the blue cards and some of the multicolor cards in the set. Yesterday we looked at all of the white cards, that video is up on the channel, and tomorrow we'll be back with the black cards and so on and so forth until we get through the entire set as we always do. Quickly before we get started, just a quick reminder, if you check out the description below, you'll see a link to our Amazon affiliate store. If you make any purchases through those links, a small percentage will come back to help support the channel. So I really appreciate everyone who looks at those, and as always, thank you to the patrons on Patreon that help make these videos possible. Now that we've said that, we got a lot to talk about. So let's start talking about, first off, blue in general as a color in this set. Now, what's kind of nice, and I mentioned this in yesterday's video, is I feel like this set was designed a lot like the last Conspiracy set, where you don't have to necessarily get locked into a certain color combination or a certain mechanical ability when you're drafting. You're able to kind of move around a little freer than you have been able to in some sets over the last couple of years, for example. And that's kind of nice. It does make your drafts a little more forgiving and allows for maybe a little more creativity as well in the drafts. Having said that, blue really can pair up with any color and be a viable format. For example, if you go blue and white, you'll find yourself a lot of times in a more controlling, slower, grindier deck that's going to allow you to play some small creatures that can get in there and fight, but also some counter spells to back them up, some bounce to back them up, some flicker to get the most out of your own creatures with fabricate and stuff like that. If you go black, blue, for example, and you go into Dimir, there's an interesting relationship between those two colors because blue has a lot of the bounce spells and black has a lot of the fabricate spells. So you can fabricate, make some tokens, bounce it back, fabricate again, make more tokens, and you can take those tokens to sacrifice them to a lot of the other black cards that are using them as fuel. So I think that could be a really interesting archetype. If you get into Simic, green and blue, that's really about energy. There's a strong focus on energy in both of those colors. You're able to produce a lot of energy and then turn that energy in a lot of cases into counters for your creatures to make them bigger. Is it colors, red and blue? Also focused on energy, but kind of in a different way. They both create a lot of energy, but this time the energy payoffs are a lot of times a little more abstract. They're going to be things like direct damage spells, or they're going to be things that will let you scry and dig through your deck, so they feel a little more sorcery centric, if you will. So all these decks are viable and feel like good strategies, and looking at these cards, a lot of the cards we're going to see today individually fit into multiple strategies in different color combinations, which is very awesome. So having said that, let's jump into the individual cards. And we'll start off with Aether Meltdown. Now, this is a fine limited card for you. This actually does a lot for 2 mana. I mean, it has flash, so it comes in at instant speed. It can target a vehicle without the vehicle being turned into a creature, and it's one of the few cards, maybe one of the only cards that I can think of that does that, so that's pretty good. So if you have open mana, your opponent's tapped out, and you just want to put this on a vehicle, you have the ability to do that without having to wait for the right time, so I find that interesting. It also gives you 2 energy, so it's doing just a whole lot to take down the power of a creature. And again, because this can happen at instant speed, this is a combat trick that in some ways is going to work as blue removal. Blue doesn't have a lot of options for removal. I think overall removal is a little bit tight in this set, and it's all rather conditional for the most part. And it's a little different compared to maybe what we saw in Shadows over Innistrad. But this is probably one of your better options to go to if you're looking for a card that can take out another creature and you're in blue. Next we have Aether Squall Ancient. This is kind of a high-end curve card for your limited deck. It's meant to be a big bomb, and it is. It's a 6-6 flyer, it gives you 3 energy, and if you have the extra energy to pour into, it also returns all the other creatures back to their owner's hands. So it does a lot. I mean, it can take over a game. A couple things you want to be wary of course, with a card like this. I mean, it is expensive, so you do want to make sure you don't overpopulate your curve with a bunch of, like, 6 and 7 drops, right? Like, this really should be kind of the card you're building towards when you put it in your deck. So be aware of that, especially at the pre-release or what have you. Secondly, there are a lot of good enters the battlefield effects. So take that into account. When you play this, if your opponent has a lot of, say, fabricate cards or something like that on the battlefield, and they put those back in your hand, if they have an answer for this, if they have some kind of removal, they may be able to swing the game back into their favor. Now, same is true in your situation, though. If you have that in your deck and you're able to put all that back in your hand and then your opponent destroys this creature, you could still come out on top because you have some, hopefully, value from the cards you're casting. So this card works a little bit better if you have a lot of good interest battlefield effects to back it up. But at the same time, let's face it, this thing's still a 6-6 flyer. It's still going to be a bomb for you in limited pretty much regardless, right? Unfortunately, this won't cross over into standard. You already have cards that do similar things that are a little more economical, like Crush of Tentacles, for example, right? So because of cards like that, this won't really cross over at this casting cost. But again, it's kind of meant to just be a limited bomb, I think. Aether Theorist, a fine 2-drop. I always kind of say sometimes you're really desperate to find a good amount of 2-drops. It's the most important part of your curve in limited. This is a very serviceable 2-drop. It's a nice little blocker at 1/3. It gives you 3 energy when it enters the battlefield. It's actually pretty good for 2 mana, I think. And then also, if you tap it and pay an energy, you get to scry 1. So even if you have nothing else to do with that energy, you have a way to smooth out your next few draws. That's actually pretty decent. So again, you're getting a lot for 2 mana, and this is also a very good card to deal with some of the more aggressive strategies out here. So if you can play this on turn 2 and you're up against, say, the Boros deck that's coming at you with some 2/1 creatures early in the game, this can slow down their strategy a little bit too. Aether Tradewinds. This is a fun limited card. I've played with this before. This, of course, is a reprint. And this card is nice because it's return target permanent you control and target permanent you don't control. So it's not non-land permanent. So there's a ton of flexibility here. Now, again, when you use this card, best case scenario, you're tempoing your opponent in some way, whether you're bouncing a big creature or even if you're bouncing a land to kind of slow them down that way, it works in that regard too. And then hopefully you can bounce something of yours that has a good enter the battlefield effect, or at least something that's very cheap or easy to put back out. So there's a lot of value to be had here. You'll be happy running one or two of these in your limited deck. Next we have Ceremonious Rejection. 1 casting cost counterspells, even if they do have a narrow field, are always really good. This one, no exception. This thing is gonna be amazing, I think. Now, 1 casting cost, take out a colorless spell. Deals with artifacts very nicely. Now we're in a set, obviously, that's very artifact-centric, so I do think this is actually main deckable. Even if you just main deck one of these and boarded another one later, I think you'll get value here. There's always going to be something to hit with this thing, quite honestly. Some people might feel more comfortable boarding them in, and that's okay too, but I don't think you would be punished for main decking at least a copy of this most of the time, right? Let's talk about some other formats, because it is definitely relevant there. I think this is very standard playable, especially considering more and more artifacts we'll see play now that this set is going to hit the meta, and you still have some colorless creatures out there, some Eldrazi is roaming around that you could use this on as well. The only awkward side there is it doesn't deal with the cast ability of Eldrazi, so Emrakul is still going to mindslaver you, but you won't be dealing with a 13-13 flyer, so that's good if you can counter that thing. That's not horrible, but at the same time, it's not the ultimate answer, I guess, right? This card's also going to see play in Modern, Legacy, Vintage. It's going to come out of sideboards and all those formats. Great card against Affinity decks. Great card against Workshop decks. This thing's the real deal. This is going to see play in a lot of different places. Phenomenal card. Next we have Confiscation Coup. This is kind of like a Steel Artifact slash Control Magic type effect. It costs 5, so you're paying for the fact that you're choosing between artifact or creature, and it is making you jump through at least a small hoop with the whole energy piece. It's giving you 4 energy counters, so that's kind of nice, but then obviously you have to pay energy into steal the artifact or creature. Most of the time, 4 energy is going to be probably good enough for what you want to take, and in those rare occasions where you want to take something larger, then hopefully you have some other ways to create energy prior to playing this, and you can get there, which does lead to at least a small level of variance. But I do think, at least in this limited scene, there seems to be a lot of ways to get energy, especially in blue, so I don't think that will be a problem most of the time, as long as you're careful and you plan for using this card later on in the game, right? Having said that, very powerful effect. Very, very powerful effect. Control Magic style effects, and even taking an artifact at times can just be incredibly powerful and can really swing a game. So if you are lucky enough to open one of these in sealed or get one in draft, play it. If you're in blue, you'll be very happy that you did. Curio Vendor, another 2-drop. Again, bread and butter card. I do find it interesting, though, that it's a 2-1 and not a 1-2. That's a little unusual for blue. And there's a couple cards. We're going to see another one later that feels a little more aggressively costed than what we normally see from blue. So, I don't know. I think that's interesting. But again, this is a card that you just kind of need for your curve. It's nothing special to write home about, but it's there, and you'll be happy it's there when you need a 2-drop. Disappearing Act. Okay, this one's kind of interesting. I talked a lot about this when it was previewed, and just to kind of set this up for you, I mean, obviously in the old days we had Counterspell for 2 blue, right? And at some point Wizards felt that was too economical, and it made the game maybe a little too slow or stopped you from playing some of your spells, and they wanted to mitigate that a little bit. So we entered an era where we had Cancel, 2 blue and 1, and that was Time Spiral, I believe, was the first time we saw Cancel, if I'm not mistaken. And, okay, that felt a lot slower than the original Counterspell. And whenever we saw a 2-mana Counterspell from that point forward, it always had some sort of drawback attached to it. Okay, well, fast forward to 2016, and now we have a Cancel with a drawback. So that doesn't feel good to blue players, right? A lot of people are saying, what gives here? I mean, what's the deal? Now Cancel's too good even? And Cancel was a card that never felt like was overpowered or anything like that. A lot of times you got it in your pool and didn't even play it, depending on what your deck was doing. So I think a lot of people are kind of scratching their heads like, really? Do we need a drawback on Cancel? But I think what this is I think this is Wizards just trying to be cute, quite honestly. I mean, we saw Scatter to the Winds, about a year ago, a few sets ago. So I don't feel like Wizards has said the 3-mana Counterspell is too good. I think they're just trying to be a little cute here and trying to say, okay, here's a Cancel with a drawback, but you know what? In this limited format, sometimes that's an advantage. And in this case, that's what this card is. If you have Enters the Battlefield effects, and again, there's tons of them in the set, Fabricate cards, cards that give you energy when they come into the battlefield, other random things that appear. You have the Gear Hulks that have these amazing abilities. So now you get to counter something, return something to your hand in the hopes that now on your turn you're just going to replay it and get benefit out of it. That's the idea here, I think. Now, having said that, there is a high level of variance there that's not always going to work out, which does, at the end of the day, mean that this is a Cancel with a drawback. Now, they did mitigate the drawback, I think, the best they could by saying permanent. So they're not asking you to return a specific type of card like a creature. Permanent means, I mean, you could always just cast this and return the land back to your hand. It tempos you a little bit, but you're going to do it if you need to do it. If the threat is that bad that you have to handle it, then tempoing yourself, you'll deal with it, right? So it's not the worst thing in the world by any means. In fact, it is meant to be a very cerebral card, I think. But at the same time, it is what it is, I guess. And because of that, I don't think you're going to see this crossover in a standard or anything like that. I still think it's very playable and limited. Obviously, it is better if you have Enters the Battlefield effects to go along with it. But it's, again, another card not every limited deck's going to want. If you're more aggressive, you're not going to be playing this sort of game. If you're slower, more methodical, and controlling, then, yeah, it's still going to be a fine card for you. Dramatic Reversal, a nice little, I don't know, kind of surprise card, I guess, if you will. Another way to maybe all of a sudden just untap a big creature and take out one of your opponent's creature, especially in a set where we don't have a whole lot of removal. Now notice it does untap all non-land permanents, so that's actually kind of nice because it's not just creatures, it also takes care of artifacts or whatever else you need to untap. So I do like that, and it does have its place. It's probably not going to fit into every single deck, but if you have a lot of creatures, maybe you're playing this with blue and you're going wide and you have a lot of small flyers or something like that, then yeah, this could be a decent little combat trick in a case like that. Era of Innovation. Now this card, the more I've been able to kind of look at this card and think about it, the more I like it. When it was first previewed, I said it was a good card, but now I'm starting to feel like this is a really great card. And here's why. Let's talk about this in detail a little bit. It's a 2-drop. And it does absolutely nothing when you play it. I usually don't like cards like that. I'm not a big fan of enchantments that you play and they do absolutely nothing. This card literally does nothing. Okay, so you have to get past that. But let's go farther. Now, whenever you play an artifact or a artificer, actually, you get two energy counters if you pay one mana. Okay, so it is a reoccurring way to get energy. That could be helpful for some decks, but what's really interesting about that is that does combo really well with certain cards in the set. We're going to see a card a little bit later called Whirler Virtuoso. It'll make more sense once we start talking about that card, but just a quick summary, what that card can do is you can pay 3 energy into it to get a Thopter token. So if you do that, you get the Thopter token. If you can pay 1 mana, you get 2 of that energy back. There's also some other cards in the set, and we'll look at them as the week goes on. I think we actually might have saw one yesterday too, that when a creature enters the battlefield, you get energy. So with a combination of one of those cards, as well as the Whirler Virtuoso, you could potentially create a Thopter for every mana you have to spend, and then next turn untap and do it again. And that actually is a nice little engine. Now granted, 3-card combos can be a little janky and hard to pull off, especially in a world where you don't have a lot of tutors and stuff, right? But these cards are relatively cheap, and if they fall together, well, you know what? They fall together. And if they don't, they don't. But there is value to be had there. So just looking at that first ability alone, potentially this could see some standard play, maybe in a control shell that is using this as a backup plan combo sort of thing. Like you're still trying to win with small creatures and small flyers or a big evasion creature, and you're trying to control the game, but you have these other cards sprinkled in there, and if they happen to work out, they happen to work out. Like I could see a build like that happening in standard. Now let's talk about where this card gets really intriguing. Pay 6 energy and sacrifice this to draw 3 cards to Ancestral Recall. Now, as we've been seeing, there are a lot of ways, especially in blue and in other colors, of course, and artifacts, to get energy put into your energy pool. Now, if you play this a little bit later in the game, say maybe it's turn 5, 6, 7, play this for 2. If you already have 6 energy in your pool at that point, and you just immediately sacrifice this, you just Ancestral Recalled for 2. You Ancestral Recalled for 2. That's a pretty big deal. And I just don't feel like energy is that hard to get. Again, you have to think about what direction you're going with it and what your payoff's going to be for it. If you start throwing it out into little abilities here and there, then you can't pull something like this off. But if you are very directed to the fact that this is why you're getting energy is to Ancestral Recall with this card, that could be really, really, really good. So I think, again, this will see standard play because of that ability. I think a control deck, again, even if it doesn't do the other combo, it doesn't matter because if you have the energy to Ancestral Recall, who cares? I just Ancestral Recalled, right? That's a huge, huge deal. So yeah, this card I think is the real thing. What might hold this back from other formats like Modern or what have you is the fact that the energy creation cards aren't backwards compatible. I mean, the only place to get them is this set. So you're gonna have to find economical ones that are going to be good on their own in Modern, even if you don't draw this card. Don't know if there's enough of them to really build a deck around that yet. Maybe in the future when we get more of these cards over time, but at least for right now, I feel like this could be a really good standard card. Another card that might be fun to play with if you want to introduce energy into your commander deck or into a cube, for example, this could be a powerful way to kind of have a payoff for that energy. And in limited, I think it's another really good card for you, quite honestly. It's not going to make all builds. Obviously, you want to have the confidence that you'll be able to get enough energy to draw cards off this thing. And if you don't feel that level of confidence, then maybe you skip this card. But if you feel good with it, I would certainly run it. Experimental Aviator. This is a fine 5 drop. I mean, 0/3, and you get a couple 1/1 Thopter tokens, and this flies too, so it's a nice little blocker. Yeah, I think that's good enough for 5 mana, quite honestly. I mean, don't underestimate the power of 1/1 flyers. I mean, if you ever played with Bitter Blossom, if you played with things like Lingering Souls or those type of cards, you know how good that can be in really probably any format. And the fact that you have flicker effects, if you're playing white in this card, you have the bounce effects where you could potentially replay this even in blue, then you know what? Turning this from 2th opters to 4th opters is really good. If you happen to get 6th opters out of this, well, that's game changing. So this is a card that obviously is better with those type of effects, but it's not unplayable by any means if you don't have those effects. Again, maybe you have better stuff at your 5-drop, so it might not always make your cut if you don't have cards to support it, but it's decent. Failed Inspection, fine limited counterspell. I mean, it's a forecasting cost counterspell. We're going to see a better one in a few minutes, but that one's going to be rare. This is common, so this one's just going to be more accessible. So if you are playing the control style deck, this will be fine for you. If you're not playing that style deck, then you'll probably skip this one. Gear Seeker Serpent. I feel like this card's just kind of the, hey everybody, remember Affinity? That was cool, huh? I don't know. This card it's okay, don't get me wrong. It's going to be fine for you in Limited. I do like the fact that there are ways to get it cheaper, and considering it's starting off at 7 mana, maybe you can actually play this for 4 or 5. That feels pretty economical to me. And the fact that I can use this as a mana sink to make it unblockable, that feels actually pretty decent and limited. So it's a common. You want to be careful about how many of these you put in your deck. You don't want to gum up your hand with something like this. This is probably a one of. But as long as you have some artifacts in your deck that are going to help bring the cost down, this is a serviceable card. Other than that, I don't really see it seeing too much play. Glimmer of Genius. Now, I first glanced at this card, I was kind of like, 4. I wish it was cheaper. But then the more I looked at it and thought about it, I was kind of like, well, you know what? It is an instant, though. So if I'm in a control build, I can hold back my mana. I could hold it for a counterspell. And then if I don't have to counter something, I play this at the end of my turn. This actually feels better and better, again, the more I look at it. I mean, compared to Read the Bones. Read the Bones costs 1 less, but it's a sorcery. And it also does 2 damage to you. It does let you scry 2 and draw 2 cards. Obviously, it doesn't give you energy. And Read the Bones is very, very standard playable for a very long time. So I feel like this card could get there in a control build. I think this could see some standard play. If you do get this in Limited, I do think it's worth running. Again, be careful how many you run, considering it is a 4-drop. But a 1 of this will be enough, I think, to garner you some value at some point during the game in a 40-card deck. And I think you'll be pretty happy with it. Scrying 2 and drawing 2 cards, that's no joke. That actually can be very, very good for you. Glint-Nest Crane, another serviceable limited 2-drop. I mean, a 1/3 flyer for 2 is actually very good, nice little blocker. And you know what? If you have some artifacts in your deck that you could hit with this, even more value, wonderful. If you miss, you miss. But if you have a fair amount of targets, this could be a really fine 2-drop. High Tide Hermit, I'm not crazy about this one. I feel like it's just a little too slow for what it's trying to do. It does give you 4 energy. I mean, that's kind of a big deal. If you're really desperate to get energy, it is an option for you. But a 4/4 defender for 5 feels a little bit slow. I think by the time this comes into play, it might not really be as relevant as it could have been at maybe 1 less mana, for example. Now, yes, you can pay energy into it to attack with it, but again, I think you're at a point in the game now where it's just going to be either chump blocked and you're going to use your energy up, or it could be double blocked and you might get 2-for-1 out of it, but you're also again spending the energy to do it, which feels a little strange when there's so many better payoffs. So yeah, I think this one most of the time you're going to skip it unless you're really desperate for a 5-drop. Insidious Will. Now, this was the counterspell I was alluding to earlier, and this one is the real deal. And it is a rare. You're not going to see it all that often in Limited, but this card's phenomenal. Now, it has modes. So, I mean, the first thing people think of is Cryptic Command. Okay, it's not quite as crazy as Cryptic Command, but it's still very, very good. And just look at it this way. I mean, forecasting cost counterspell. However, if you don't want to counter the spell and instead you want to deflect it, you have that option. And not only do you get to deflect, typically a deflection type spell will say a spell that targets 1 target can be deflected. This time it lets you choose new targets for target spell. So that's actually very, very good. And you also have a 3rd ability on there, which is a fork ability. And quite honestly, that fork ability probably not as good as the other two, But there's times it could come up, right? Every once in a while it might be relevant. Let's talk about the fork ability first. I mean, when do you want to use that? Sometimes you might want to use it if your opponent's playing something that's benefiting them, that you can also get the benefit out of it. For example, maybe they have a card draw spell. You can fork it, draw cards yourself. The only thing that's awkward about that is you're exchanging then that fork spell for this counter spell. And a lot of times if your opponent's going to draw some cards, you may want to have a counter spell on hand to deal with whatever crazy thing they draw into. So that's a little strange. I mean, another way you could use it is maybe you cast a burn spell and you want to fork it, but that starts to get pretty expensive considering this thing costs 4. That's a lot. It's not like the original fork that only costs 2, right? Now, take that third ability away though, and you still have some really strong, good abilities that are very, very flexible. It lets you deal with, say, a burn spell coming at you, a removal spell coming at your creature. It lets you just counter something big that they're trying to put on the board. It just does so much. So yes, this will see play in Standard. I think because of this card, it really makes a control deck a viable thing that we will most likely see happening in the Standard meta game. A fantastic card, and the art on it too is amazing. Janjeet Sentry, decent 3-drop. Actually, there's a lot of upside for this 3-drop. You get 2/3 body, that's fine. That feels like it would have been worth it on its own. Also gives you 2 energy. And then if you don't have anything better to do with the energy, you can pay into this to tap or untap target artifact or creature. So yeah, it just does a lot. It gives you some versatility. Really decent 3-drop for limited. Longfin Skywhale. Now, this is the type of card that blue is trying to use to put its damage forward, right? When you're playing the more slow, controlling, methodical deck, you need some sort of big evasion creature that is reasonably costed, and that's what this is. The drawback being it can only block creatures with flying, so sometimes you're behind and you have a lot of ground pounders coming in at you or small creatures on the ground, and this isn't going to feel good when you draw this in that situation, right? But you know what? It's definitely worth the risk because this is going to be your offensive card that's going to help you put away the game in limited. Next we have Malfunction. This is kind of the claustrophobia style card for this set. Now it does deal with artifacts or creatures, so that's a nice little bonus. But let's face it, I mean, this is pretty much blue's removal card. I mean, this is the most consistent removal card you're going to find in blue in this set. And it costs 4, so it's a little pricey, but let's face it, you're going to need one or two of these in your limited deck if you're in blue. Now, granted, there's some other colors that do have some decent removal that you could be playing with that could compensate for your blue removal, but at the same time, if blue is one of your major colors, this will probably be an important card for you. Metallurgic Summonings. Now, this is a mythic. This is a very interesting card, and I'm looking at this, trying to assess it. I've thought a lot about this card. And there's certain things I like about it, certain things I don't like. I mean, the biggest drawback for me is I'm paying 5 for this thing. And again, it's an enchantment that's doing absolutely nothing when I play it. And I'm paying 5 mana. That's quite an investment for 0 payout, at least immediate payout. Now, I have to have instants and sorceries really to make this card great. That kind of makes me feel like not a good limited card. It's a mythic, which is kind of sad if you open a mythic and you don't play it in your limited pool, but I think that's the case with this card. Most of the time in limited, your decks are going to be very creature-centric. So, instance of sorceries, you'll have some, but will it be enough to warrant running something like this? I really don't think so. Let's talk about Standard a little bit. Again, Standard doesn't want to play a 5-drop that does absolutely nothing. Now, is the payoff good in a control deck? The payoff's good in a control deck. I mean, exiling it to get all your sorceries and instants back to your hand, that actually feels really strong. And if any deck could swing the mana cost, it is a control deck. I think the question is this control deck that we'll find in the Standard meta that efficient that it'll be able to let its guard down long enough to play something like this? That's the big question, and I don't know if it could honestly quite get there. Where does this card really fit? For me, it's Commander. I think this is actually a really cool Commander card because Commander is a little bit slower. You have a little more breathing room in a multiplayer game. It does allow you to play some spells to get some small creatures initially, and then later on bring those spells back, continue to grow your board state. But I think that's the format where this makes probably the most sense. Minister of Inquiries. Okay, 99% of the time I'm just not even touching this card. A couple things with it. First off, if you're trying to use it to mill out your opponent, I mean, sometimes that's a viable option in limited 40 card decks and all, but this time, this is not a set that's really helping you mill. I mean, this is pretty much one of the only ways you can mill your opponent. So picking up one of these, notice it's uncommon, it's not common, so it's gonna be hard to pick up multiples. Now, granted, in a draft, nobody might want this card. If you really wanted to, you might be able to pick up a few copies, but it's just way too inconsistent. The fact that you would want multiples of these to really try to mill out an opponent, it's gonna be too hard to get multiples. Even if you do, then you need the energy to back it up, and these things are gonna start eating through energy very quick, probably quicker than you're going to be able to eat through your opponent's deck in a lot of cases. It just doesn't feel very efficient at all. Now, the other way you could play this is you could try to mill yourself. Now, if you did that, what's the payoff? Well, there's a few cards that do give you some payoff, like Refurbish in white, for example, if you were able to mill like the 10/10 Colossus and refurbish it, or really just any decent artifact creature. I mean, you even have Gearhulks if you're really lucky that you could get, stuff like that. So is there kind of a side play there where that could work? I don't know. Maybe it just feels, again, a super high level of variance, especially in limited, where you're not going to get a lot of these pieces. You're just going to get, maybe one refurbish and maybe one good target, right? It just feels very janky. So, quite honestly, steer clear of this one. I think this one's a big trap. Nimble Innovator. This is another card I'm not super crazy about. I don't like paying four for a 2/2. Yes, it replaces itself. That's nice. And you know what? If I flicker this or I bounce it, there's more value to be had. That's the only time I consider playing it. If I'm in a limited deck that had a lot of good flicker effects or something like that, then it's a little different. It just becomes another target that I could get some value out of. But again, it is taking up a spot at the four drop. And let's face it, that can be a rather powerful spot in your deck, and you don't necessarily want to gum it up with too many four drops. So I think most of the time this doesn't make the cut, but at rare occasions, I mean, it might work out okay. Padim, Council of Innovation. This is okay in limited. I mean, it's kind of nice to have a way to protect your artifacts if you're running a lot of artifacts or artifact creatures. So this card does this. It's a four casting cost, but it gives you a 1/4 body, so it also can block some things too. It's decent. And hey, occasionally you might even draw an extra card off of it. It won't happen all the time, but when it does, that's crazy value actually for four. So I do think this is very playable and limited. I think where this card's really going to shine though is Commander. It's legendary, so you can actually make this your commander, and it might be a really interesting commander in an artifact-centric deck because it does protect your artifacts. If your opponent gets rid of it, you can play it again later and have that protection, and you can craft your deck to perhaps a good percentage of the time get the card draw off it as well. So I think that's where this card is really going to be amazing. I don't really know as far as standard if there's a place for it. I mean, obviously it kind of wants to fit into an artifact-centric deck. We will be looking at artifacts in a few days, and there are a few artifacts that really feel like they're trying to create some sort of like slower standard version of Affinity, and maybe this is a good card to complement a deck like that. So if that can make it in the meta, this could see standard play, but I guess that still remains to be seen. But if nothing else, I mean, a good commander card. Paradoxical Outcome. I think it's kind of a fun card. I like the versatility here. It's an instant, it costs four. It lets you return any number of non-land, non-token permanents to your hand. So it's not like those effects that are making you like wipe all your creatures or something. It's letting you pick and choose what you want to return to your hand, and then you get to draw a card for each card you return that way. So you're getting card advantage off of this, and hopefully you're picking up things that are either relatively cheap and or have good enters the battlefield effects. And I think that's the whole concept here. And the fact that it's an instant, you can do it at the end of your opponent's turn and replay these permanents on your turn, feels actually pretty good to me. Like, I would be very happy to run this in limited. I feel like there's enough upside here. Even if I don't have great enters the battlefield effects, returning a few small cards to my hands, like small artifacts or small creatures, and replaying them and drawing the cards, that actually feels really good. So, yeah, this is a good card. I don't know if it will see play in standard. It feels maybe a little slow and conditional because you have to have the targets on the battlefield, and you might not always have that, especially considering you're investing four mana in this. But I think it's a cool limited card, and again, it's another card that could get a little more of a bump in like a commander format where you have more flexibility. Revolutionary rebuff. Now, I usually like counter spells like this that are the, you know, force your opponent to pay two more and they're cheap. They only cost a blue and one. This one feels super narrow to me, though, in this environment. The fact that these cards become dead cards later in the game doesn't feel good typically. And then this one also could be a dead card quite a bit of time if you're looking at the fact that it can only hit non-artifact spells. So I'm just envisioning a situation where this is sitting in my hand, and in the early game I'm like, all right, I'm ready to spring this, and my opponent's playing these like small artifacts or artifact creatures, and it's just sitting in my hand, and then eventually they get enough mana that it just doesn't matter anymore and this thing never gets to do anything. Now granted, that's a very specific situation. This can still find targets, but I don't know, it just feels a little too inconsistent for me, even in limited. I think this is more of a sideboard card. I'd bring this in if I saw my opponent was playing less artifacts, especially at the lower end of their curve. At that point, I'd be a lot more comfortable playing this. Saheeli's Artistry, it's a 6 drop, but it's a very powerful 6 drop, but you're definitely getting your money's worth for this card. This is a great limited card. Now granted, you have to have targets, but what's nice is it can target anything on the board. It doesn't have to belong to you. So this can target any artifact and any creature that's out there, so that's kind of nice. And again, 6 mana, it probably would have cost you more than 6 mana to cast 2 of these things anyway in most cases, right? So this is very economical in a lot of ways. Great card in limited. I think this will be a limited bomb for you. I do think it's a little too expensive and situational for standard, because it's a 6 drop and the targets have to be there, so that's a little awkward. I do think this card shines in multiplayer games, though, where there's more targets. So again, this is another card that will be really good in Commander, I think. Select for Inspection. This one's okay. I feel like there's better bounce spells in this set. And if you don't have those better ones, then maybe this is okay for you as a replacement. But I don't think it's always going to make your cut. It is only one casting cost. It's kind of nice. It is an instant, so that's always good. But the fact that it has to be a target that's tapped and it can only be a creature too, that means the creature had to do something to you already. It already had to, say, attack you or what have you before you get the value out of this. So sometimes this kind of sits in your hand, waits until you can use it, and that's a little awkward. It also works on your own creatures, so that's cool too. Again, if you have an enters the battlefield effect you want to exploit, that's probably the only time I'd really feel comfortable just main decking this outright, is if I just had a lot of good targets for it and I didn't have any better bounce spells. You do scry one too, I do want to point that out. So I mean, there's a lot happening here for one mana, but I just feel like there's other ones that are just a little more flexible and a little better. Shrewd Negotiation, to me this is just kind of a fun card. There's a high level of variance here whether you can cast this or not. It's not something you want to play in standard, but yeah, you know what, you could run one of these and maybe just for fun and limited. Eventually you'll probably have a moment where you'll have a profitable trade to make, hopefully. I think this is again better in multiplayer games where there's just more targets out there, like Commander. I think it'll be more fun in a situation like that. Tezzeret's Ambition. I think most of the time you're going to have at least an artifact in play in this format, limited. So paying 5 for drawing 3, those are typically good spells. Now, you don't want to muck up your deck with these. Like, this is a one of. You know, just play one. It's a common, so don't get too crazy in the draft with these things. But running one of these will feel good. This could potentially see play in standard, maybe a one of or two of in a control deck. These type of spells have seen play before in standard, so sometimes they make it, sometimes they don't. It just depends on what other options are out there. Thriving Turtle. This one feels a little more like a sideboard card to me. This is something you want to board in if someone's playing a super aggressive build against you. A lot of small creatures are attacking in on turn 2 or turn 3 with some 1-2s or 2-1s and that type of thing, and you just need to slow the game down a little bit. At that point, you bring this in. It's nice that it also gives you energy. I mean, that's pretty cool. I don't really see you attacking in with this or spending the energy to get +1/+1 counters on this, quite honestly, most of the time. But it's, like I said, it's there if you need it if you're trying to deal with a hyper aggressive build. Torrential Gearhulk. Well, here's our second mythic of the day, and it's a Gearhulk, so you know it's the real deal. These are all amazing. When I first saw this card, I think this was the third one previewed, I believe, and the other two had cost 5, so I was a little disappointed that it wasn't quite as maybe offensive as some of the others were that we saw, but it's still really, really good. I mean, you're still getting a 5-6 flash, nice little combat trick, and you get to play an instant for free out of your graveyard. Notice it is instant, not instant or sorcery. This case, it is just instant, but that's okay because there's burn spells you can grab. There's counter spells you can grab. So if you have 6 mana up and you can throw this out, block a creature and or counter something or burn something, there's a lot of value to be had here. So again, works great with flicker effects if you're playing with white and that sort of thing. So really fantastic card. This is a limited bomb, obviously, and I do think this could cross over into some standard play potentially in the control deck as well. I also like these things in cube. Like, I would like to see a cube maybe switch out Titans for these and just kind of see how they play. This just feels like a very unique, really cool cycle of cards. Vedalken Blade Master. Not too much to say about this. I mean, this is a good 3-drop in limited. 2/3 body with prowess. Yeah, that's economical. And we're in a set with tons of artifacts, so that can really help trigger the prowess. I'm surprised maybe we didn't see more prowess cards because they work really well with Fabricate, but maybe that would have been too good. I don't know. So yeah, if you're playing with Fabricate, this is a fantastic 3-drop. Weldfast Wingsmith. Now, back in my day, we had Phantom Monster, and it cost 4, and it was a 3/3 flyer, and that was that. Now we have to jump through hoops to get our forecasting cost 3/3 flyer in blue. But you know what? Other than, well, I guess Eternal Masters, where they did reprint Phantom Monster, other than, you know, the original Phantom Monster, you didn't really see a whole lot of cards like that in blue. So this is fine. This is actually really good, to be honest. Getting a 3/3 for 4 in blue actually feels good. You don't always see that in blue. A lot of times if you're paying 4, you're getting cards like 2/4s or 1/5s or stuff like that. This one's a little more aggressive. And you know what? Artifact enters the battlefield under your control, gains flying. Wonderful. That's going to happen enough times, I think, that you'll get enough value out of it. Again, another card that works good with Fabricate, for example. So yeah, this is very, very runnable. I think this is a really good creature for you in blue. Windrake. I love Windrakes. This, of course, is a reprint. It's been reprinted many, many times, and it's always good and limited. And we've seen other color-shifted versions of this card in the past. They're always very efficient. Nice little flyers in the 3 spot. Always happy to play them. Next, let's look at some multicolor cards. We're going to look at the Lone Dimir card in the set, and it's Contraband Kingpin. This card totally makes sense with what Dimir is trying to do. When you get into black, you're seeing a lot of Fabricate cards. So you're going to have the potential for a lot of the servo tokens to come into play, and when that happens, you get to scry. And also, this is a nice little blocker with lifelink, so it does slow the game down a little bit and defend you against some of the hyper-aggressive strategies that are out there. You do want to keep in mind, it is a 2-color card, so it's probably not really a 2-drop all the time. Maybe it's a 3-drop some of the time, or even a 4-drop, but even so, I think it's still a very good card. I mean, whenever you have the ability to scry, even if it's just occasionally, that can be pretty powerful, and I really like the size of this creature for 2 mana and the fact that it has lifelink. Alright, so let's move on to Izzet, and here's one of the big ones, Sahili Ray. Now, this is interesting because I think the community in some ways was a little split on this card. Some thought it was really good, some thought it wasn't so good. I think it's good. I think it's actually very good. Here's what I like about it. 3 casting cost planeswalkers are good. even if their abilities aren't like super impressive at times, or at least don't seem super impressive, the amount of value you're getting out of your 3 mana potentially on turn 3 is just overwhelming with these things. So let's look at her specifically though. First off, she has 3 loyalty. That's actually pretty decent. So she automatically ticks up to 4. Okay, that's pretty good. Her plus 1 ability, I think, is the bread and butter here. This is a great ability. Scrying 1 and pinging an opponent. That does a couple things. The scrying 1, especially early in the game, like turn 3, turn 4, turn 5, it's smoothing out your draws. It's letting you get to the land you need to get to, or if you have too much land, it's letting you get rid of the land and get to your heat. It's really smoothing out what your deck's trying to do, and that's awesome. The ping ability is okay, but if your opponent happens to have a planeswalker on the battlefield, it becomes much, much better. It keeps that planeswalker under control. That's a big deal. The minus 2 ability is pretty good. It allows it to almost quasi defend herself a little bit, right? Like, she can't really outright defend herself, but if you have a creature that you're basically would have to hold back to block her, now you can copy that creature, attacking with a token, and still have the blocker. That's kind of nice. Now, again, I wouldn't go as far as to say that's flat out 100% a way to defend herself all the time. It's a little conditional, but it kind of works some of the time, so that's cool. Now, her ultimate, very, very good. Now, obviously, you have to have targets for it, which may or may not work out for you in limited. And if you have the targets, or you just need one good target. If you have one good target, that's awesome. If you don't, then you know what? The plus one ability, I think, is just plain good enough, quite honestly. And the fact that you're just going to gain life because at some point your opponent's going to want to attack her instead of you. All that for 3 mana, sign me up. She's awesome. So I think it's clear to say she's a limited bomb. I don't think anyone's really arguing that she wasn't. But the fact that you take all of what I just said about limited, you apply that to standard, I think it's all good there. In fact, it gets even better because you have cards like Liliana, the Last Hope. She can keep Liliana in check and hopefully keep her off that emblem. That's actually pretty huge because a lot of times what those decks are trying to do is just slow down the game, control the game, and build up their Liliana. This time, if they gum up the game, Saheeli will prevent that from happening. That's actually kind of awesome. And again, in standard, you can have better targets for her ultimate as well. So you can put something in there, maybe a Gear Hulk or a few Gear Hulks, or I don't know, like the 10-10 Colossus that we're going to look at in a few days or whatever, right? There's definitely better targets that you can find there. Also, the -2, again, you may have better targets to use for that too. So there's just so much going on with this card. It just has so many different options. And yes, I think it's definitely standard playable. This card may shine most, though, in some of the Eternal formats, where you have better targets, better artifacts that you could go get. This card could do a lot in, say, Vintage. I feel like in some ways it might feel a little more like a Dak Faden-style card that might work better in those Eternal formats because the targets are better for it there. So yeah, watch out for this one. This is going to be great, and I think it goes without saying it's going to be a really good commander card and really fun cube card too. Most planeswalkers are, but this one's unique in some ways, so I really do like this. All right, our last card of the day. I kind of spoiled this earlier. We talked about it already. Whirler Virtuoso, and this is the last Is It card. And yeah, there's value here. I mean, you're paying 3 for a 2/3. You're also getting 3 energy. And if you want, you can just pay that right into getting a 1/1 Thopter token. And this is a fantastic energy payout. I mean, if you are creating energy, you want something to do with it, this is one of the best things you can do with it, quite honestly. And you're able to pour that energy, whether you get it through a fairway or you use a combo like we talked about earlier, you can make a lot of flyers. So to sum up, yes, definitely limited playable. I think this could potentially see standard play, like I mentioned earlier. I think someone could brew something with this. But even if you're not trying to get cute with it, you know what? It's still a great payout for your energy just to get a bunch of flyers and just do some damage. Maybe this could slide into a version of the tempo deck that's already out there, and Is It, maybe with a few changes, a card like this might work in there. I don't know, but I feel like someone will brew something. It will definitely get there. And again, if you want to introduce energy to a cube or to a commander deck, for example, this is one of the big payoff cards, I think, where it really makes sense to do so. All right, having said that, those are all of the blue cards and some of the multicolor cards too. So we saw white yesterday, we saw blue today. We're going to be back tomorrow with black, and we're going to keep doing this every day until we get through the set. And then we'll wrap things up with a pre-release primer as well. Hopefully get you ready for the pre-release. So hey, as always, thanks for watching. Please remember to like and subscribe, and have a great day. Hey, thanks as always for watching. This video, like all my videos, was made possible by the generous support of viewers like you on Patreon. Even a donation of $1 helps me to keep growing this community and creating better quality content for all of you. Check out our Patreon page for exclusive giveaways and future goals for the channel. If you haven't yet had a chance to subscribe, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss any of the MTG news, spoilers, set reviews, product openings, or finance videos on Heroes and Legends. Talk to you again soon, and have a great day.